Hey everybody, Jittery Jay here. Hope everybody's having a great day so far, or at least a better one than I'm having. Still in a little bit of pain from my surgery, but I'm getting through it. Didn't realize how much the pain pills they gave me were helping until I ran out of them. But I've got my own pain medications for my nerve disorder, so that helps. Anyway, that's not why we're here. We're here because we finally reached the end of the second season of An Idiot Abroad. This one is season 2, episode 8, Carl Comes Home. If I remember right from the first season, this is like a synopsis or a summary of what he went through during his travels, which some of it we may have seen already, some of it we may not. But before we get started, as always, we're going to hit the like and subscribe on the original video. That is the important part of what we do, is to show support wherever we go. Speaking of which, everything will be linked in the description as always, so you can go check that out. And then come back here and watch this with us. Anyway, let's get into this.
The Bucket List. See the glaciers before they melt. Go on an African safari. Encounter the world's largest mammal. The ultimate things to do before you die.
It's still a bummer that he was sick and didn't get to see the whales. that one got me because he got seasick really bad.
Mammal.
When he finally got to the whales,
the
they were gone.
Things to do before you die. Or are they?
I travelled right across the other side of the world. It wasn't what I pictured.
Sure, we got the right house.
I stuck my hands in rhino shit.
Yeah.
Had a taste of that. Yeah. It's horrible. I was proper struggling, I was losing weight, and I was starving.
That's rank.
No.
That does stink, have a whiff of that.
I liked the hippo in the house. That was the best of everything.
There you go.
I haven't quite got over it, and my heart's pounding still, because it doesn't know what's gone on. And that's what you're like with this trip. You've nearly done me in.
I remember that part too.
Hello, and welcome to episode 8 of An Idiot Abroad 2. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Stephen Merchant.
Hello.
And the star of the show, the little round-headed twonk, that is, Carl Pilkington.
All right.
Well, Carl's been around the world again. Thank you for your questions. We're going to get to those. But first, I want to ask, why did you do it again?
Right.
You swore you'd never do it again. You swore on camera.
It's a job, innit? Just got to earn a living. I'm in a programme called Idiot Abroad. Job offers aren't, you know, whizzing in.
Right. Yeah, they really put him through the ringer this time around. If you thought the traveling was bad last time, the stuff they had him doing on some of this was crazy. Like this part here where they had him on top of the wing of the plane. And I'm surprised he actually did it, but he wouldn't do the bungee jumping. So, but I'm actually surprised he wouldn't do the bungee jumping since he actually did this here. That's what I'm trying to say.
No.
Right here.
No. That is massive.
You chose the opportunity to be on a desert island, private island. How did you find that experience?
But you saw it. It wasn't a great experience.
It looked beautiful to me.
Fucking freezing.
It's just a bad start. It's like moving on a rainy day, this. I thought it was going to be sand. It's all bloody rock.
Right.
I travelled right across the other side of the world. It's pissing it down. Mm. It wasn't what I pictured, that's what I'm saying. When you have a dream, your head puts everything as you'd want it to be.
Right.
I'm not sure Ricky would be happy about this, Carl.
I don't give a shit. There's no way he'd be putting up with this. Pop it over your head. Keep warm.
To be fair, stuck on a little island, dressed in leaves, with it lashing it down, and you having to build a shelter, like a chimp in a tree with gaffer tape, Right. Wasn't my idea of heaven either, to be honest.
No. In my head, I was picturing...
A bounty advert.
A bounty advert. That's what I was picturing. White sand, blue sea, right. Couple of palm trees.
Half a coconut with a bounty.
When you think of being stuck on a stranded or stranded on an island, that's what you picture. The palm trees, the blue sea, the sandy beaches. That's what you picture when you picture being stuck on it. Because your mind always creates the best possible scenario sometimes. But it's just not... Reality doesn't always mix with that, if that makes sense.
White sand, blue sea, couple of palm trees.
Half a coconut with a bounty in it.
Bounty in it. But the point of that is, on the bounty advert, it's 30 seconds. She's loving that bounty. Mm-hmm. But she was pissed off after she'd eaten it. And that's the reality of it.
Yeah.
You don't look at the bigger picture, you go, that looks nice, and then you move on.
One thing I've always wanted to do, and I hope I will get a chance to do it, which you did, the swimming with sharks. It looks amazing.
Yeah.
It's all right, yeah.
Good. Okay. Yeah, cheers. Brilliant.
It's just all right, yeah. He was supposed to be swimming with dolphins. That was the problem. Just his response here. It was all right, yeah.
That's all right, yeah.
Good. Okay.
Thanks for that, mate.
Yeah, really, cheers. Brilliant.
You brought that to life.
You can ask me how to paint a picture.
It's hard, though. Other people will always have their experience of it, and it's what they thought of it.
Right.
This is mental, this. I can see him. Just look at me.
But tell us your experience, how you felt.
Right, I felt sick.
That would be cool.
I'm not very good on boats. I thought I was going out for a night to see a dolphin. Mm. It turns out it was two nights on a boat to see sharks.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not great on boats. I was in a room that stunk of prawns. I thought everybody's room smelt like that until someone came in and said, Jesus, what's going on in here? See, the thing is, people are only thinking these things are good because they've seen it on the telly. Mm.
They don't see all the work that goes into it.
They don't see all the hassle, the work.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Is this how you imagined it?
No. No, I didn't. Oh, fucking hell. They sat there, these nature programs that are getting a gorilla, sat in the thing with its family, and they put nice music on it. All the sounds and stuff. Gorillas traipsing through with the family. Oh, look, it looks amazing.
Body popping.
It's in bright, sort of bright, you know, HD. Oh, that's amazing. I'd love to be there.
I said reality doesn't always match.
And in reality, my toes were bleeding, I had headache, I was being bit by mosquitoes, and I got there, and the first thing I saw was the mum gorilla sticking its finger up its kid's arse. And you don't see that as something that you go, wow.
Yeah, I think they will. I think people will watch this and go, wow.
This one has been one of the wonderful tracks.
Wonderful?
Yeah.
Okay.
I may say 10 out of 10.
He said part of the gorilla trek was it's all about the hunt and finding it and looking at them. No, it isn't. Bring it to the hut. Bring it to the tent, sit it outside, I'll look at it for a bit, shift it. That's seeing a gorilla.
Carl, we're often accused of bullying you. This is a recurring thing, isn't it, that we bully you. But both of us, and Ricky in particular, is always concerned about your well-being, particularly in Alaska, if you recall.
You are not going to be eaten by a polar bear. But when you had your medical, I found out that you didn't let them test your prostate. Did you?
No.
I forgot about this.
No, but that's...
Why not? In the UK alone, more people die every year from prostate cancer than being savaged by a polar bear.
It's a bit of a weird time to bring it up when I'm in the middle of nowhere.
It's one of the biggest killers, right? And that's just a simple test. So a doctor pops his finger up your anus... And he goes, yep, you're all clear. And that's you relaxed for another year.
I don't understand why you're suddenly caring about this now. I've got little battery left on this phone. I'm wearing the battery out. If something happens, I'm dead.
Right. He's my best mate. Sue me. I'm worried about him.
Yeah, yeah.
No, but why isn't there ever anything about how's your blood pressure? Oh, how are your feet? You're in the cold. Are you warm enough? Are you... No, because it was none of that. It was,
yes, I know.
Why don't you get a finger up your arse?
Because often there are no symptoms.
Well, I don't want it done.
I know you don't, but it's...
Ricky's got a point. There's very little indication of something like that going on. You can be perfectly healthy and still have problems with your prostate. I would not know it. So I see where Ricky's coming with that.
Up your ass.
Because often there are no symptoms.
Well, I don't want it done.
It sneaks
I know
up
you
on
don't,
people.
But it's good for you. So can we bring the doctor out, please?
Oh, God.
All right, well, this is a waste of time, then.
This is Frank. That's Carl.
Frank, how's it going? You all right? Good to see you.
Is the consultant urologist at St. Bart's?
Yeah, St. Bart's.
Yeah.
The thing about prostate cancer is you can be perfectly well and yet still have prostate cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
One of the ways that we can detect if that may be a problem is a rectal examination.
The thing with feeling...
I don't want to finger up the arse, though. Wait, you keep going on about this.
Right.
I've told you time and time again. I mean, I presume there's a lot of ill people knocking around that Frank should be looking at. Instead, he's here debating with you two whether he's going to shove his finger up my arse.
How long will it take if you did it now? If you went... No, wait, how long would it...
15 seconds.
15 seconds.
That's a long time. As far as I'm concerned, what are you looking for?
What we're looking for, okay, it's two things we're looking for. One is the size of the prostate gland. Number two, it's the consistency of it. In other words, what it feels like. It's a quick, simple thing to do.
Carl, can I tell you what's going to happen? It's going to be about 10 seconds. He's going to say, you're all clear. You're going to say, what was the fuss about? And you know you haven't got prostate cancer.
But not today.
There's no better time. Because
maybe it's that you and I and the cameras and that are making it a bit intense.
Oh, we've
maybe
got
if
a private
they went privately to
we've
another
got a private room.
Step.
We've got a private room.
You wait here, then. You stay here.
Wait here. Frank, do you want to follow Carl? Can you show Frank and Carl to a private room? Thanks. You may as well check his testicles while you're there.
So what's the rules here? What's...
I knew it wasn't private. I had to know it.
It's just the way they go about it. I've been travelling around the world in dangerous places. They've never cared about me before. Mm. Yet today, they keep going on about having this done.
Men are embarrassed about these things, you know? We're not used to these things. But for the sake of something that really is very quick and painless, we're talking about potentially saving a life. And before you know it, it's done and it's over.
I know, but it's just...
I do this day in, day out.
That's what you do, seriously, every day?
Yeah.
Every day of my working life, that's what I do.
And are you going to move up and get to do something better, or is this your future?
Sticking your fingers up
his arms. It's just part of the job. Yeah. A lot of time I spend in operating. A lot of time I spend in clinics.
So how many people are you doing a day?
10 to 20, maybe.
And which finger is it? Is it a big one or a little one?
It's the index finger.
Why is that? Why not just a little?
Because the prostate lies a little bit in. If you get your hand, you couldn't... You just couldn't do that with your little finger.
So you're going round a corner, you've got to go in and round.
You've got to go in and then slight twist. It's the thought is worse than the actual delivery, let's put it that way. It's the thought of it.
All right, and okay. Let's do it then.
Let's do it.
Do you wear gloves?
Yes.
Do you know Richard Blackwood?
Yes, the comedian, yes.
Yeah, he had a colonic on telly, yeah. Never seen again.
Yeah, what you need to do is
bend
your knees up. Yeah. Over there. So, what I need to do, I'm just going to get some lubricating gel. I'll just... Right, so what I'm going to do, if I may, I'm just going to pop...
Yeah.
Sorry. Oh, it's hurting a little bit. But this is funny. Just watching their reaction to it is hilarious. Because he's actually going through with it. But for them, it's a joke. But for all intents and purposes, it is a very serious matter. It's a very serious condition, too. So it's a very important test, we'll put it that way. But the way they're going on about it is what's cracking me up, just watching those two. I knew it wasn't a private room.
Right.
There's no way.
Yeah.
Pop your trousers down. Bend your knees up a bit more. Come towards me a bit more so you're at the edge of the couch. Marvellous, OK? Take a deep breath. Deep breath. And out, OK? And relax, breathe normally. I'm just going to pop a finger in there, OK? Deep breath, well done.
Jesus, well done. That's high up. Fucking hell. Right, that's surely enough, isn't it? Right, you're touching a lung.
Well done. Wow. Your prostate's fine.
Yay! You actually did it.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Well done.
Brilliant.
I don't think it's the sort of thing people pay a
guy a subscription for, to be honest.
In HD.
Well done.
Cheers for that, then, Frank. Now, you are a doctor, aren't you?
Yeah.
He waited until after the test before. You're not a doctor, are you? That's a question you would ask beforehand. Just to make sure. Ouch.
Google me. You represent the men who will never have it done, some of which will die of prostate cancer. Genuinely.
I haven't quite got over it. My heart's pounding still because it doesn't know what's gone on. My body's gone, what just happened then?
Hmm.
No one's ever been that high up.
Oh, God.
So you're a human magnet?
Mm-hmm, they're magnet. Magnet.
So tacky. Look, they're not special or anything. What is going on? I've never heard of such a thing. Handy when out shopping. When you go food shopping. Carrier bags these days are really weak, but very thin. He comes out of Waitrose. Done.
Right.
I can't think of anything where you go, brilliant.
Yeah.
I'm a magnet. When do you need to be a magnet?
What superpower would you like, though?
I came up with one. I'd be bullshit, man. There's so many meetings going on where you know people are bullshitting. I'd just like to walk in. I wouldn't need a special costume. Just dress like this. And I'd fly in, I'd go, bullshit. You're talking bullshit. And they'd go, oh, it's bullshit, man. And I'd go, yeah, it is bullshit, man. You're talking bullshit. Okay. And eventually, people would stop talking shit.
That could take off. I quite like... I mean, I know you said you didn't want a costume, but if I could get a little costume for you, what colour would it be?
I don't need a costume.
No, but you don't need it, but if I got one for you, what would it have?
No, I don't need all that, because that's just wasting time.
It's more bullshit. But how do we know you're bullshit? How do we know you're bullshit, man?
Because I flew in.
You can fly. So your superpower is saying bullshit, but you can also fly.
Yeah, but also people know if I've said it's bullshit, they know they were talking bullshit.
Yeah, but wait.
That's my superpower.
No. No, your superpower is surely flying as well. You didn't.
We bullshit, can all man. Say bullshit.
No, yeah. The flying is necessary because of the amount of bullshit that's going
but
on.
But if you could fly...
But if I can't fly, how am I going to get around this loads of bullshit? What are you going to do? Keep jumping in the cab?
Wait.
I'm going to be busy all day. Right.
I haven't invented this. It's not my fault you can or can't fly.
No,
calm down.
I know, but I'm saying if it was my superpower, I'd want to fly in.
Yes, my point...
And I don't want a costume because I'd be constantly wearing that costume because of the amount of bullshit that's being said.
Yes, I understand that.
So
your point is this.
Oh, he's definitely got a point. He'd never be able to take the costume off because of the amount of bullshit that goes on in this world. Anyway.
The amount of bullshit that's being said.
Yes, I understand that. So your point is this. Everyone can tell bullshit, but you need to fly to get there quick and get it out
just
in the open.
Can it quick.
Yeah.
Someone starts spouting
how
the bullshit.
How can you hear them? So you can super hearing as well. Yeah. So you can... Hold on. So wait a minute, right. Can you see where they are? Or can you just...
I'm just hearing it.
So if there was a meeting, right, going on in Leeds now... And there was a bloke going, well, if you invest in this company, if you give me 1 million, I can guarantee you will make an extra million
right.
by the year. And I will double... I will...
double,
I will double your investment in 1 year.
What? Bullshit! That's how it would work.
You can see how...
I know, because, honestly, that's years and years of people spouting it.
Yeah.
Meetings, ever since being neck-high. Mm. It's like... That's all you ever hear.
Okay, but how would you
programs in X Factor? Honestly, X Factor would keep me busy.
Okay, yeah.
Just the amount of shite
Yeah.
That is being told to people in that, and all that crying, that'd be the next one. I don't know what I'd call it. That thing when girls do that now, I don't know where that's come from. When they're getting a tear coming on, they go like that. I want to fly. Fucking stop doing that. That does stink. Have a whiff of that.
Oh, no, it's not, I'd say, but smell. It's a good smell.
That's rank.
No.
It is.
No.
I've found that I've enjoyed food more since I've got back from Japan.
Because you appreciate...
Just nice food.
Right.
Yeah, but that's only because you're only saying it's not nice because it's different. That, I mean...
No, it wasn't nice in Japan. I was proper struggling. I was losing weight and I was getting moany because I was starving. And there was nothing. I was going around saying, have you just got any toast? And they look at you like, no. Oh. And they give you like a squid bollock. It's just nothing. That's for breakfast.
Yeah.
It's not like they save the weird shit for tea. That's breakfast.
They start you off with weird stuff.
And the hard stuff. And do you know what? I didn't tell them, the people who were away with me, but I was struggling that much on two mornings to try and get through it. I was eating strepsils because I found that my taste buds went numb and they didn't have a clue what was going on. And I just was shoving stuff in. Have a big bit. Have a little big bit. Have a big bit. Don't start saying you don't understand me now. I'm going to be sick. There's something in the middle of it that's really grim. I'm going to be sick in your Japanese garden.
Pretty good now at just shoving anything in. I've eaten geckos. I'm not that fussy. I've stuck my hands in rhino shit.
Yeah.
Had a taste of that. This isn't me being a bit, it's fucking horrible.
Apparently that's like the start of sushi. That's where it all began with that. How did it carry on? Why didn't someone say, what is this shit? Pack that in, stop serving that, and that should have been the end of sushi. Mm. 170 quid.
Okay, what do you recommend? What should they get over there?
Just have a look at any other country's menu. Nip into any restaurant, get a menu and go, oh, right, that's what people like eating. Yes, it is, not phlegm. Just something normal.
You've got a point. The thing is, for them, that's something normal. You know, it's different cultures have different tastes, have different... what's the word I'm looking for? Shit, what is it? They have different priorities, I think is the word I'm thinking of. As to what they consider food, it all depends on what's available in your area. It's what you consider food. Not everywhere is going to be the same. But yeah, I see where he's coming from. For him, it'd be something different and awful. For them, it'd be something normal.
Just something normal.
It's bloody massive, isn't she? When she cuts out of the water. Oh my God, it's letting its own.
What's my salivation?
That is mental. That is mad.
Yeah.
Your dad didn't let the cat in the lounge. Fucking hippo in here.
That was the best of everything. An animal here that normally kills people.
Right.
It's a number one killer, a hippo. Right? You have to trek. You have to stay well back. You can't see. You've got to look at hippos through binoculars. Suddenly, there I am in a house where someone's got one as a pet. A hippo in the house. Tea on demand. Biscuits when you want them, hippo in the front room. That is the ideal. Why I always see them in the same surroundings,
because
always
it's
in a lake?
Cruel.
It's not cruel.
In this case, it can
it
go free.
It would have been dead.
It would have been dead, it was saved. But could I just say that wild animals should never be kept as pets?
Right.
You can't suddenly start keeping wild animals in council houses in case you pop round for a biscuit and want to see one.
I'm just saying, that for me, I'll never forget it. It's a surreal moment. You've seen hippos out in the wild. It's boring.
Boring. You know, they can open their mouth 180 degrees up to 4 feet wide for a full-grown hippo. They are one of the more dangerous predators there is. They have short tempers, and they take to just about everything. with those tempers. But anyway.
You've seen hippos out in the wild. It's boring.
I've seen hippos in their natural habitat.
Boring.
What chair are you sitting in?
How good would it be, though?
Where's the carpet, you fat git?
So you're telling me you'd rather queue up at the zoo to see some animal sat like that on a rock looking fed up than walking into a house, not knowing what's in there, going, oh, what's in here? Wandering in, oh, that nice plasma you've got. Oh, nice sofa. There's a gorilla in the corner. Honestly, taking an animal like that and seeing it in normal surroundings makes it even weirder. Right. It's amazing. I'll never forget it. I'll forget a lot of the other things.
But the hippo in the house was the highlight.
Hippo in the house was brilliant. That and the volcano, they're the highlights of the whole thing. Fucking hell.
Why was the volcano so amazing?
Just because it's madness, it's dangerous. You stood on the edge of it. It makes you realise that the world is alive. You don't think about that, do you, when you walk about?
I'd rather have one in my front room, though. I'd go in, I'd go, oh, nice plasma. Yeah, new carpet. Volcano. Let's have some marshmallows. I'm not walking. I've got one here.
You've got little ears. Long arms. Short legs.
Is this your speech?
Isn't that a tragedy that some of these species could be gone in a few years? The mountain gorilla that you saw, now...
Yeah, there's only 700 and odd of them
so
left.
So precious. Yeah. So precious.
And yet you didn't really want to trek for it. You'd have rather it came around your house.
And yet poachers are still killing them. You know? It's because people are still paying for the hides. It's just like... The way a lot of endangered species are, is the more endangered they are, the more precious their hides are for poachers, unfortunately. I'm willing to bet that's how we've lost quite a few species.
Precious. So precious.
And yet you didn't really want to trek for it. You'd have rather it came around your house.
I wouldn't want them wiped out. We're saying they're the closest thing to human, so what's wrong in having them in your house? That's a very human thing to do. Treat them like a human if they're very close to being human. Come on in. Sit down.
All right.
Of course I don't agree with them dying. Because there's people who kill them just for their hands so they can have an ashtray of a gorilla hand.
How disgusting is that?
Well, it doesn't work. That doesn't even work as an ashtray.
Right.
The ash is going to roll through its fingers. It's a bit chavvy as well as a design. My furniture wouldn't work with that. Nothing to do with is it nasty and all that. It's a horrible thing.
You mean if it was a fake one made of...
I'm just saying a hand. Forget it's a gorilla. A human hand.
If it was a piece of art, a ceramic...
It doesn't work.
No, it's the cruelty that I find disgusting.
Yes, but it doesn't work.
Not the design. It's a beautiful design, a gorilla hand.
But it doesn't work.
When it's attached to its fucking arm.
But a hand it doesn't work properly, does it?
Yes, we're not talking about whether it works. We're talking about how vile and disgusting it is.
It is, but think about it. If there's anyone out there who is vile and disgusting, it doesn't work. As a thing on a table, if you're putting your fag on it... Go like that, the ash rolls through the fingers.
No, it's balancing perfectly.
It doesn't work. That's the message that should be out there. Don't have a gorilla hand, not because it's cruel and that, which it is, but it doesn't work.
Double
message. If his head was there,
because it doesn't
work. Cut his head off, you can put fruit in it. That works. That's cruel, but I'm just saying it doesn't work.
One of my favourite things about this show isn't just getting you to exotic places or out of your comfort zone, it's you interacting with people.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
I love this.
Are you gay?
No, I've got a girlfriend, 17 years.
Fuck boy.
Hey?
Fuck.
Safety's on, that's an AK-47.
Yeah, I've heard of them. Crisp, biscuit, fruit, wiggly worm.
My favourite bit, I just think, when he was... you know, cooking for the king, and then he got caught up in the moment, like it's suddenly his kitchen, when they go, they want another pudding. Who does? All of them. I've only got one tin of custard! Like, suddenly, but he's the king. Not in my kitchen. I'm Carl Cookie Pilkington.
Pudding?
Am I seeing things, or does Ricky keep making his eyes go crossed? Watch his eyes when he does this.
like suddenly, oh, but he's the king.
Not in my kitchen.
See?
I'm Carl Cookie Pilkinson.
Pudding, yeah. Chocolate, sponge, custard.
Thank you.
Quite warm. God, I'm knackered. No wonder Ramsay's always swearing.
Carl?
Yeah?
I think they want another round of cake.
Who does?
All of them.
I haven't got enough. I bought one box of custard.
You took it so seriously.
Because what's the point in doing anything if you don't? Mm.
Really? Good point. He's a great character.
Like I said, every once in a while, like I've said before, every once in a while, Carl drops a gem. That was one of them. Let me bear in mind that.
I haven't got enough. I bought one box of custard.
You took it so seriously.
Right here.
Because what's the point in doing anything if you don't?
Exactly. Good. That's a really good point. What's the point in doing anything if you're not going to take it serious? You know, it doesn't matter what it is in your life. If it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. You know what I mean? That's an old saying, but it holds true. So I get where he's coming from.
Because what's the point in doing anything if you don't?
Right.
Good point. I mean, there are some great characters in this. One of my favourites is the Russian taxi driver. I'd love to get him over.
Oh,
him.
I yeah.
Show him around. No,
wouldn't you know? I was stuck in a car with him in busy traffic in Russia. It was a nightmare.
Hope you do not value life too much and got good life insurance. The brakes in this car just failed. It's the worst car I ever bought. It's British, and I never thought a car could be made that bad.
Ooh,
right.
I think we found the Russian equivalent of Carl.
He's been stuck in a car with this miserable bastard.
But he was saying the same thing.
He felt you were a miserable bastard. He didn't like you.
Russia, though, is quite... It felt like that. It felt like you're not meant to be happy. Maybe he's your bog standard Russian. Everything's quite hard. Signs, the text on buildings. I've never been a lover of font. I think there's too many fonts.
Right.
But after being over there, they've got like one and it's in capital. It's yelling at you. Yeah. Even if it's something nice. Kittens for sale. Everything's fucking sharp.
Now, despite the fact you didn't really get on with Russia, the Trans-Siberian Express journey actually threw up some of your favourite things. You ended up at the Dwarf Village.
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was really good. I mean, how can you fault that? It was just slick. You know, you had, like, a little Rich and Judy come out at the beginning. They sort of introduce everyone. Different singers. It was like our life, but miniature.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a little Britain's Got Talent. There was a little Peter Andre who came out, did a little sing-song. Little woman with glasses on, Lily Allen. It was just really familiar. Enjoyed it. And people at home, you'll probably get some going, it's not right.
Mm-hmm.
Shouldn't be looking at dwarfs singing and dancing on stage. But we do it with X Factor. The early stages of that are a load of divs. Everyone knows it. The people coming aren't pretending they're here just to see singing and dancing. They know the dwarfs. Everyone's having a good day.
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with it, really? So if I was a dwarf, I'd definitely come here. Wouldn't hang around at home. There's nothing for you at home. You don't get looked after like this. You don't get given little houses and a stage to perform on and all that.
Mm-hmm.
I've always thought being small would be all right. Being a dwarf, I'd rather be a dwarf than like Steve, who's almost a giant, because the world's not made for a giant. Being a dwarf, being on a plane, loads of leg room, king-sized Twix is massive. The world's overpopulated, especially in China, and they're like over 1 billion people. Perfect. You want to be smaller, more room. They need more of them, actually. And then I look at it and I think, is that how we're meant to have evolved? Maybe that is the future. Maybe we're the odd ones out here, when you think about it. Be a dwarf.
That's not good advice. Be a dwarf. Well, how?
Right, fair enough. I'm just saying that it was one of the best times I had, that. And I think more people should go and visit, because that is helping them out. And something they haven't sort of tapped into, but I think they could make money from, is sort of renting themselves out to people who don't know if they want a kid or not. Because even though they were grown men,
There's something that makes you want to sort of go like that on their head. Mm. Too many people just
pick them. Yeah, yeah. But would the dwarf have to affect the mannerisms of a child?
They kind of do. The way they are around you, they're sort of laughing and joking.
That's what a normal person is, and most people are sort of laughing and joking.
Right, what's your idea then? What would you get them to do?
Get them to do anything.
But they haven't got any work over there.
But they can work.
Doing what?
In offices.
No, they can't, because the tables are too big for them and stuff, aren't they? You've got to start accommodating them. And nobody wants to.
But we do that with wheelchair access.
I'm just saying, you're all a bit like, oh, you can't say that. Well, yes, you can say that, because there's a load of old bollocks.
What do you want to say? That we're?
I'm just saying there's nothing wrong with it. If one of them wants to act as a kid, rental, he should be allowed to.
If one of them, I'm just saying, like if one of
rental.
Them, kid rental with dwarf.
Now, of course, we asked viewers of the show to ask any questions that that they'd like to ask of you, and we can put them to you. And this is from Sarah from St. Louis in Missouri. Hi, Carl. Just wondering, why are you friends with Ricky? You have completely opposite personalities, and he loves to annoy you. What do you get out of this relationship?
That's a good question.
That's a good question.
I don't think we do have opposite personalities. I think we're very similar.
No. No, we're not. But I think that's what I like, the challenge of it. It's like having a dangerous pet. You never know, it could end up killing you. And that's what you're like with this trip. You've nearly done me in a few times. Right. I can be quite happy, and I go, I feel a bit too content. Mm. Call Ricky up. 2 minutes, that's all I need. Wish I hadn't called him.
Sure. Makes you feel alive.
Bucket list. What do you want to do, Carl? I want to drive down Route 66. All right, then. What are we doing?
You at the cuddle party.
Couldn't stand it.
I don't understand why you didn't just have a cuddle with someone.
Well, with strangers.
Yeah. What difference does it make?
I think a hug is there for a reason.
What's a hug there for?
You hug someone when they're fed up.
Mm. Well, I'm fed up now.
No, you're not, though.
Well, look.
You're abusing
look,
the hug.
Look, Carl,
you're not gonna get
Carl,
one.
Look.
Yeah, well, you're not going to get one when you're doing that.
But we're
I
not strangers.
I'm a bloke anyway.
Well, no.
I don't hug.
You said it wasn't to do with male or female, you said it was to do with being a stranger's.
Right.
I know you better than anyone apart from Suzanne.
Yeah, well, I'm not. I'm still not happy with that.
How would you feel if I scooted up behind you to spoon you? Would that be okay?
Well, that's worse than a cuddle.
That is a cuddle.
That's more than a cuddle. Right?
What if I put my back to you and I face the other way?
That's all right, because that's just because we're all... It's crowded. Touching like that, that's just like being on a
so
tube.
So I could do that?
But you don't touch people on the tube.
You do. In London, you do. It's a nightmare in rush hour.
Really?
You'd love it.
It's ridiculous going around cuddling strangers. But mates...
Always hug. Do you want to hug me?
Yeah.
Well,
only if it's all of us. I don't want him to feel left out.
I'm not left out. You have a hug. You know each other longer than you. No, I'm not having a hug.
Come on.
Get off.
Come on, have a hug.
No,
this
is... Right.
Come on.
I'm not happy with this.
Get him down there. Come on. So, hold on. I think you should be on the floor and we should have a little man wedge. Do you want to get on top of me, Steve? Let's have a little man wedge.
Well, I want a piece of car, like.
I know, but you can have a little man wedge. Oh, that is so... See?
Fucking hell, I think
oh, God! Well, if you've got one, I have too, Steve.
Is that Frank again?
What is your program?
The program?
The program, the name?
Idiot Abroad.
The board?
Idiot Abroad. Idiot. Just... I'll write it down.
Idiot Abroad. Abroad.
Abroad. Idiot Abroad. That's the program. The name of the program?
What you back no? Idiot Abroad.
Yeah, don't shout
idiot
at that.
Idiot Abroad,
yeah,
the name.
I know, I didn't want it. It was meant to be Carl Pilkington 7-1.
Idiot.
Yeah, I know.
Abroad.
Yeah, it's not good. Yeah, there's a name. Yeah.
Idiot.
No pet. Yeah. But I'm not. I'm not idiot.
Just
a friend came up with the title.
I'm not idiot.
No.
Just only the name.
I know. But ignore the name.
Idiot. I'm bored.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me ask you another question from our viewers. Here's one from Gareth Sutcliffe, and he says, Carl, French novelist Marcel Proust once wrote, the voyage of discovery consists not in seeking new landscapes, but in having new eyes. With that in mind, could you sum up your travel experiences and offer your view of travel in a similarly meaningful quote?
Don't piss arse about travelling, getting jet lag, eating food you don't like, shut your eyes and imagine stuff.
Wow.
Beautiful.
Okay.
Wonderful.
I've had the shits.
This part was funny.
This is good. Cools you down. That's going to give you a headache, not get rid of one. Look how complicated it is just for a toilet. You have the skill of Bill Gates. Just have a shit. You can't do any of that. Can't do that stuff. But it's a robot. It's a crisp picker-upper. If you want some crisps but you don't want to get crisps on your hands, you use a crisp picker-upper.
Okay.
I like the fact that you've got a bit of a rebellious streak in you sometimes. You go off-road. And I called you when you were in Japan and you dropped this bombshell that you've finally decided the one thing you want to do before you die. And that was to invent something. And you said it's because you wanted to leave a legacy, which I thought was brilliant.
All right.
Well, just because you're dead longer than you're alive, aren't you?
Okay.
I'm coming up with stuff all the time.
Again.
That's why I think this is my strength.
Again. Carl with his bright insights. You're dead longer than you're alive. So you got to make your life count. You got to go for what you want. You know? Seize it. Like the saying says, seize the day. In other words, go after what you want. It's not going to just drop into your pocket or into your hand. So, yeah, I like that.
Okay.
I'm coming up with stuff all the time. That's why I think this is my strength that hasn't been used yet. I can't do this sort of thing, really, this sort of job of being on the telly. Look at Dyson. It's only a vacuum cleaner, yet he's up there with Einstein and everything. He's well-rated, just for a vac. And I reckon I can come up with something better than that. It doesn't have to be a cure for cancer. I'm not going to come up with that. All I can do is come up with something that I needed at the time and that I think other people will go, do you know what, that's a bloody good invention.
So something that benefits mankind?
Yes.
Right, yeah.
Okay.
He pitched me the idea over the phone and I said, I'm out.
OK, well, pitch it to me now, then.
Right. In Japan, they don't have these...
You mean they don't have...
Chairs.
They don't have chairs?
Yeah, of course they have chairs.
You try finding one. You sit on the floor all the time. When you go in a restaurant, you sit down cross-legged. You get a flat arse and your legs ache.
Yep. Right? So you've invented what?
It's the Pilco pump pant.
I'm sorry, the Pilco pump pant.
It's a pair of pants with a cushion built in the arse. Inflatable pant. Stops your arse from getting wet. For men or women. Do you know the thing you put on your neck when you're on long flights?
Yeah.
I've used that. That isn't how the finished thing would look when I make it.
Right.
This is a prototype. Pilco pump.
Excellent.
The Pilco pump.
I sold some on a shopping channel. You're slagging them off, you're saying I'm out. Watch this.
But this is the lovely man I was talking about. It is our lovely Carl to bring you some trousers.
All right, how's it going?
Hello.
Oh, no, he did.
Morning, everyone. Hope you're well. It's the pants we're selling today. Look at that. Not bad, that, is it? You've come on the telly to flog me a pair of pants. We know about pants, we've seen pants before. You haven't, though, have you? You haven't seen these pants. It's that bit there, that's the seller. That's what we're here for, that's what we're talking about. It's the Pilco pump pant. The way it works is you've got a big zip, a good quality zip. Look at that. Doesn't stick, it's a quality zip. Doesn't stick, quality zip. All right? Open it. There it is. There's the cushion. You might have one of these already. Shove it in there.
You know you're going to be sat down for a while. You're waiting for that order of the sofa. You're waiting at the bus stop. You haven't got a seat because the queue's big. The buses are delayed. Where are you going to sit? Well, the beauty is you can sit where you want. Sit on concrete. Sit on the road. Not on the road. That's dangerous. Sit on the pavement. Sit on the grass. How good is that? And there's only 15 pairs available. 15 pairs in the whole world. Do you want to be one of the 15?
Still 15 left.
To have the Pilco pump pant.
Look at him. Look at him in them.
There you go.
It's ugly.
It's terrible.
Show you how easy it is again.
It looks like some sort of medical procedure, doesn't it?
That's what people would think if they saw you walking.
They think that you think you've had your ass removed.
Get rid of that. Yeah. Look at that for a pocket. Look at that. Like I say, we're carrying more and more stuff around with us.
Think of carrying stuff in that.
Your arse. Rattling around with stuff. Yeah. Mobile phones.
Football.
Laptops, iPads, all that lot.
Fruit.
Look at that. Look at the size of that.
Who's
pocket.
Putting a laptop in their arse?
Bread. You nip out to the shop.
Milk, loaf, bread.
You don't buy a carrier bag. They're charging you 5p a bag at the moment at the supermarket.
Yeah.
No, I'm not buying a bag. You just turn round at the cash point, stick your milk in there, stick your bread in there, off you go. A big, big pocket. You've got this. Health and safety these days. You've got that in there. You like a walk. Maybe buy some for your young kid. You're walking by the canal. He falls in. Is he a good swimmer? I don't know. You tell me. But if he falls in, he's got something to keep him buoyant.
Upside down like that. He's like that. He's drowning.
Fall in a canal, a lake, a river. Anything else goes. Hang on, let's see how the orders are going. Have we had anyone calling in yet?
Two people on the phone. What do they want? Do they want to talk to me or is that just...
They've gone. We've sold them. Job done. Brilliant.
Cheers for that, everyone.
These are how they look in real life.
This is the Pilky pump pant.
Pilco pump pant.
Yep.
OK. I mean, it looks ridiculous. It does look ridiculous.
So does most fashion these days.
Okay, no good. Yeah, no, yeah. If it was, yeah, no, you're right. Yeah, it's all out down.
He's got a point. It looks ridiculous. So does most fashion these days. Yeah. Have you seen some of the fashion shows? Oh, my God. It's getting more and more ridiculous the farther they go. Now they got the, what is it? The duct tape outfits or whatever the hell you want to call them. Gorilla tape, whatever it is. Anyway, it's getting crazier and crazier out there, folks.
Ridiculous.
So does most fashion these days.
Okay, no good. Yeah, no, yeah. If it was, yeah, no, you're right. Yeah, it's all arbitrary.
Sit down.
Yeah. Where's the chair? You don't need a chair. That's doubled up. You must be too comfortable. Sit on the floor.
Right.
Sit on the floor there, because that'd be.
And I suppose particularly useful if you've had a finger up the arse.
Right, there you go. So.
Right.
Yeah.
Dead comfy.
Yeah.
Really comfy. Mm.
Carl, can you go and bring me my sort of bread and milk and stuff that I've...
Have you got 5p for a carry bag?
I haven't, no.
Well, I haven't. Hang on, don't worry about that. See you in a minute. What did you want?
Oh, bread and milk.
Some groceries, yeah. Imagine walking down the street wearing that. Absolutely ridiculous. Carl, it looks fucking ridiculous.
He doesn't know.
It does.
It looks like that.
Oh. No one will walk down the street like that. Hold on, Carl. I bought you.
No,
look, Carl.
There's no restrictions.
I've bought you a couple of cups and saucers. Yeah. Can you take? I bought you these for you.
Got a bag?
I haven't got a bag. No, just pop them in there.
Pop them in.
Just. Oh, well, can you?
Shove them in.
Yeah, just put them in there. There you go. Suzanne's at home.
With our new crockery.
Honestly, that isn't pulling me down or anything. Oh. That is fine.
It's absolutely ridiculous.
No, well, you'd bubble wrap them normally, wouldn't you?
Unbelievable.
You're still walking around with them.
Wow. I just want to say, Carl, I was impressed all the way around with the stuff you've done. I like the fact you didn't do stuff you didn't want to do.
I thought it showed real drama and resolve. You weren't just a puppet. Uh-huh. You weren't just an idiot, an adrenaline junkie. You were doing things that mattered to you. Is there anything, though, you didn't do that you wish you had? If you could do it again, would you go, do you know what, I will do that now, I will bungee jump, or I will... Is there anything you wish you'd have done that you didn't?
In Japan, I wanted to do karaoke.
What would you sing?
Do a bit of Chaz and Dave.
Pause that, just cut into that music a little bit so I don't get copyrighted. I've seen the light, oh, reggae. There ain't no pleasing you.
You seem to think that everything I ever did was wrong. That looked like fun too, right there.
Almost. It would have been better if he was sliding down instead of scooting down, but yeah. I should have known it all along.
There ain't no pleasing you. I can't even be angry with you because you are so useless.
You only had to say the word.
Bullshit.
And you knew.
Come on, you guys gotta cut the music out.
Fucking hell! Now everything I ever
done was only done for you. Carl, I think you can sing. But now you can do
just what you want to do. I'm telling you.
I'm not doing it.
That one got me. Hang on. That got me. Right there. 'Cause I ain't gonna be made to look a fool. That outfit right there. That got me. It looks like, what the hell were those things? The Teletubbies? The one with the thing on his head? That's what he looks like.
I'm not doing it. 'Cause I ain't gonna be made to look a fool no more. You've done it once.
Just get up and keep rolling. You can do it.
Yeah. And if you think I don't mean what I say and I'm only bluffing, you got another thing.
I remember that too, where he told him he did the bungee jump, but he actually didn't. Coming, I'm telling you that for nothing. Oh, Ricky, I
believe it. Fuck me! That's what I'm
going to
do.
Stop it there. I didn't realize that was just like a summary of every place that they've been, just about. But anyway, this was a great episode. Carl's come up with a couple of good ones during this one. I still like that one. You're dead longer than you're alive. Because what it implicates is that we only... The fact that we only have a certain amount of time here and we have to make the best of it that we can, you know? There's no point living in, what's the word for it? Misery. There's no point in that if there's a way out of it. You know what I mean? You got to make do with what you got and learn to appreciate the little things in life. You know what I mean? Anyway, this was a great episode. I'd really like to hear you guys' thoughts on this one, as well as anything else you need to check out in the comments, and I'll get there as soon as I can. That's just about going to wrap this one up. I hope you guys enjoyed watching this with me, and I hope to see you on the next video. I love you guys. Peace. Hey guys, make sure to check out one of my other videos right here at Jittery J.